Well, as a solution for future traffic headaches, the state's two largest cities are hoping to resurrect part of our past.
Talking about streetcars here, and Ellen McNamara looked into the cost and safety concerns, and tonight she examines why streetcars ultimately failed the first time around.
For old-timers like Russell Olson, streetcars bring a smile to his face.
Well, you could sit there with your arm in the windowsill in the open air, and you're riding out in the country on these country lines. Why, is it really? That was fun.
For two summers, the 82-year-old worked for Twin Cities Rapid Transit, the company that operated the lines. But even Olson wonders about a future for streetcars.
They're good. I like to see them come back. But the problem is, you've got to have ridership that can support the investment.
At its peak, 530 miles of track ran from Stillwater to Excelsior. In 1920, more than 230 million people hopped on. But slowly, ridership declined. During the Depression, it tanked. World War II brought people back, but after the war, cars were affordable.
The automobile really did kill the streetcar, not just in the Twin Cities, not just in Minnesota, but across the country.
Buses were also an option. And because Twin Cities Rapid Transit was a private company, historians say they just couldn't compete.
The private property owners were caught in a squeeze between rising costs, an inability to raise the revenues and the fare, and it became a no-win situation.
Ads like these were sold, but the company wasn't making enough money.
The economics of the streetcar were pretty dismal.
1954 was the last year streetcars operated in the Twin Cities. Despite the history, Minneapolis and St. Paul are working to fund new lines.
I think we've gone full circle. People are tired of commuting from the suburbs.
Federal money will be part of the equation, but taxpayers will likely have to subsidize the lines. An estimated $50 million per mile isn't sitting well with many business owners along one of the proposed routes, Grand Avenue in St. Paul.
It seems like a total mismanagement of funds, taxes, when there are so many other things that need attention.
They also worry about congestion.
Picture a streetcar in this lane of traffic that stops every single block. Cars behind it, throw in a few bikes and hardly any room to park, and you can see why people would be frustrated.
The Grand Avenue Business Association says 75% of its members oppose streetcars on Grand, and most don't want them anywhere in St. Paul. They say they hope city leaders look to and learn from the past.
Well, by the time this project's done, they might be out of office, moving on to something else. Meanwhile, the next politician that comes into office and all the people living in St. Paul are the ones that have to, you know, fund this project and figure out what they're going to do with it.
As I worked on this story, the General Motors streetcar conspiracy, also known as the Great American Streetcar Scandal, kept coming up. Some people believe that lobbyists for the car companies essentially put streetcars out of business. But every person that I interviewed said that conspiracy is just that. There is an old streetcar that you can still ride when the weather's a lot nicer near Lake Harriet, but the look of that car is not coming back. Minneapolis and St. Paul plan to have more modern-looking cars like you saw in the renderings. Ellen McNamara, 5 Eyewitness News.